Our next speaker is the perfect mix, really, for this conference. He has extensive experience from academia, and he's an entrepreneur with a lot of industry experience also. He is an internationally leading researcher in computer graphics, and he has been consulting some of the most famous digital film producers, ranging from Pixar and to James Cameron's Avatar, and Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings, where he actually also received an Academy Award for the technology behind Gollum's skin, something that has given me a lot of sleepless nights. So I'm excited to hear more about how you actually technically create that. He's also been appointed honorary professor at Aarhus University, but he lives and works in California and as his chief scientist at the company Luxion. The company has offices in Aarhus and in California and specializes in computer graphics, among many other things, famous for developing the 3D rendering software KeyShot. And this is software used for visualization of products in design, advertising, and architecture. So it is my pleasure to give a welcome to Henrik Wann Jensen.
Thank you, and thank you for having me here today. And it's great to be here. And it's correct, I span sort of academia, and now in Søren Eskildsen's world, I've become more of a do-it guy. So I've joined an industry, but I'm going to talk a little about today about some research that I've been doing for many years and sort of how we've applied that in various industries and now looking at applying that in the real world to basically replace photography with computer graphics. So one thing I always like showing this slide. So one thing I've been doing for many years, and people ask, "What do you really do?" I explain why do things look the way they do. So I'm really good if you have sort of kids that ask, "Why is the sky blue?" And I'll sit down, I'll talk to you for an hour and 20 minutes, that's the time for lecture, explain to you why the sky is blue, why is ice blue, why the Spotify has these colors, why the rainbows look the way they do. I recently met one of my neighbors and said, "Can you do rainbows?" And he probably regretted asking me that question. One of the algorithms I worked on early on in academia is called photon mapping. Here's just an example of an older scene here. It's an architectural scene where the only light source is the sunlight that's outside the scene. What photon mapping can do is it can simulate how light bounces around inside a scene and fills the room with light. And if you didn't have photon mapping, but you have an algorithm called ray tracing, which many people call a state of the art, this is all you get. So you can see how it can fill the room with the light. This is still an algorithm that's actually used. Here's finding Dory. All the light that's underwater is all computed using photon mapping. So all when you have the waves forming the surface, you get these focusing effects of light that are really complicated. And photon mapping is really good at doing that. So it's used quite a bit for that and has been used in quite a few movie shots. Another thing I've been looking at is materials. Why do materials look the way they do? And in particular, I was looking at if you have sort of natural materials that look very soft, you have sort of light shining through them, you get this translucency effect. And that is caused by a phenomenon called subsurface scattering. If you simulate a marble bust, where you ignore that, you get a very hard appearance, as you see on the left. If you include the subsurface scattering, you get a softer appearance, you see on the right. It turns out for human skin, that can be quite useful. If you have, again, the left image where you don't do it, where the people used to do, you get a very hard appearance, it looks like way too much makeup. This is a very simple model. If you have the subsurface scattering, you get sort of much softer appearance, you get sort of light penetrating inside the skin and coming out, and you get more natural appearances. So this was work that I did quite a few years ago, and it was used, as was mentioned, on Gollum. They didn't have this technology in the first Lord of the Rings. If you look at Gollum in Lord of the Rings 1 and 2, they had to redo it because in the number 1, they had the first technique where he looks very hard and too much makeup. And then in the second one, the third one, it actually has this. One thing you notice is that the ears start getting this translucency effect. So they really like that. So the early characters in movies using this technology had really big ears. There's also Dobby in Harry Potter, where you can see that. Now, one thing I was hoping for is that they'll do an actual human character in a movie. That's still something that people are working on, but there's this phenomenon called the uncanny valley, which movie guys are very afraid of. What happens is, as you make things that look increasingly realistic, you start out with maybe something that looks like a doll, and then as you get closer to a realistic human character, if it's not quite there, it becomes creepy. Then the person starts looking sick, and that's called the uncanny valley, where it's a zombie or a dead person. and you don't really want that. So you have to be really, really good to achieve a human character for movies. So we tried to ask ourselves, what can we do to get there? And we started simulating skin as layers. We had different layers in the skin. You have the top layer, epidermis. You have the dermis and the bloody dermis. These don't look like skin, but when you combine them, you get something that looks more skin-like. And one of the first movies that was used in was Avatar. Still not quite human characters. They're a little afraid, so they had instead had blue skin on the characters here. What we did have was one of the guys who did work on Avatar modeled himself. He's a very talented artist. This is not a 3D scan. He actually modeled his own face. And what's interesting about this picture is it has a left side and a right side. One side is a photograph, and the other side is a rendering that he did on himself. And I'll just let you look at it for 10 seconds and guess which is which. And I'm not going to tell you. We went even further and started looking at one of the problems with these sort of complex materials that have all these layers is that it's hard to control. How do you set subsurface scattering for the epidermis? So artists didn't really know that. So we made a model where you just specify melanin concentration, blood concentration, and melanin type, and just the three parameters. And with that, you get some pretty good skin. But one of the things we did with that was we went tried to go a little beyond computer graphics and say, does this actually match real-world data? So what we have here is measurements of different types of human skin and how the response is as a function of the wavelength of light. And we can actually see we can match the data pretty quickly with just a model of three parameters. So pretty excited about that. Another important thing for humans in movies is hair. So it turns out if you look at an individual human hair, there's a lot of stuff going on in that. And the way we went about that was we actually started measuring it, looking at it in microscopes, and really understand that. It turns out hair is kind of like a glass cylinder, but with these angled cuticle scales on it that gives rise to lots of interesting effects. And again, as always happens to us, it seems, it wasn't used on humans in the first movie, but in this case on a monkey, so it was King Kong. But it's been used quite a lot now. And then another movie it was used on was Tangled, where all the hair in the movie was done using this new hair simulation technique. And one thing you notice in particular is what it can do is if you have the highlight on the hair, the shiny part on her hair, right next to it is a color bright region as well. And that's actually sort of a thing that people didn't really do before this technique came out. So the last thing I'm going to talk about is sort of a research example says it's actually we did a simulation of sort of tried to ask, if we mix molecules together, can we then predict what it would look like? So what we did here is we took a glass of water, then the second glass on the left is a glass of water with vitamins in it. The third glass is a glass of water with proteins in it. The proteins scatter shorter wavelength, so it looks blue on the front where it's illuminated, and red on the back because the blue light has scattered away at the front. The glass in the middle is then a glass of water with fat globules. They scatter the light independent of wavelength, so it looks white. And then the three glasses on the right is the skim milk, regular milk, and whole milk. So what we could do is we could adjust the amount of protein and fat concentration in it to actually make the different types of milk. And of course, this is useful for computer graphics, for rendering, but who's using it now? Which is interesting is I went and talked to a dairy company in Denmark, and at the time, they were using sort of like a spoon they took inside the milk to basically do a quality control. They'd look at how much fat and protein is in the milk that we sell. And they said, hey, we could use this, because if we illuminate the milk, and you can predict what it looks like based on the fat and protein concentration, we can actually replace the spoon, which might be polluted, that we're putting inside the milk. So today, they completely changed it. So now they have lasers illuminate the milk, and they predict from the footprint of the laser how much fat and protein is actually in the milk. So that was pretty cool and being used now outside of just the computer graphics area. So sometimes people ask, so when you predict materials, how does it really go about? How do you come up with these equations? And I thought since this is a innovation festival at the university, I'll also talk about that. So how do we actually get there? How do we just sort of think, oh, here's a big equation, and then it looks nice. So we started looking at clothing and wanted to understand that a few years ago. So we took lots of pieces of cloth, and they all looked a little different. And we wanted to really see, could we come up with a mathematical model that describes why clothing looks the way it does. If you look at clothing, sort of a lot of it is made of fibers. The fibers are spun together in threads, and the threads then weave together to form different clothing patterns. And we thought the work we had done on hair could actually be used in this case. And if you look at all these weave patterns, there are lots of different complex weave patterns as you zoom in on the clothing. So the first thing we did was we had an apparatus where we could illuminate the clothing from an angle, and then we could see how much light is reflected in other angles. And unfortunately, when we did that, we got a graph out with lots of weird peaks. And we started trying to think, what could cause that? I mean, why is it shining in all these different directions? And it turned out to be really difficult. And we spent a lot of time on that. And the poor student that I put on this, he's like, can you please let me graduate without having to figure this out? And unfortunately for him, I said no. And, but fortunately for him, we also finally, after a lot of thinking, were able to figure out some of the reasons for why it looked like this. So one of the first things we did was we said, okay, what about measuring individual threads? So if we took these, do they really behave like human hair? So we took all of the threads out of the clothing and put it in an apparatus so we could have a light and a camera swing around the fiber to measure it. And what we observed is that actually different types of light reflection. What you see, there's a light source coming in, and then some hair would reflect light in a very shiny way in a focused cone. And other types of fibers would reflect it in a sort of spread out, be very diffuse. And that gave us a hint that there's something different going on inside the clothing. What it turned out is actually two types of threads that are used in most types of clothing. There's a thread that's twisted. When you illuminate that with light, it spreads out a lot. You get a very soft appearance. But then you also have threads that are flat, that move through. And they act almost like a mirror. So they're very shiny when you illuminate them. So that was our first sort of aha moment. So we developed models for individual threads in the clothing to describe how do they reflect light. And here's then some examples of photographs of these. You can see some of them have pretty interesting shiny regions, highlights on them, as we call it in graphics. And these regions move around in strange ways. And again, we had a hard time predicting, understanding exactly why that is. We looked at this for quite a while. And our next aha moment was taking the threads out and looking at them. And what we saw was that they had these sort of flat regions, some angles going on. And basically turned out that modeling exactly these regions, precisely like little mirrors, that was the last key to getting the clothing correctly. And once we had that, we could now start doing clothing. So we basically say there's a thread that goes through the clothing like this. And if we did that, we could now simulate the appearance of lots of different clothing. Here's linen, and here's some silk, and now we can get all these different highlights on it. This is silk wrapped around a cylinder. If you illuminate it and photograph it with a flash, you get little light reflections that looks like that. And then even more highlights here. And so we get even four. We looked at this for the longest time and just thought there's just no way we can do this. This is just too crazy. Or rather, the student did. So. And here's some more again we did. And even velvet we could do. And then, of course, some pictures here at the end. And then the output of that is basically being able to do like a silk pillow. Instead of having to guess what it looks like, now you can actually say this is based on the way silk is weaved together and the threads and everything. So it's very nice to have these predictable models we can predict the lighting coming out. And now we're adding more clothing in KeyShot. I don't have any examples now, but we're adding so you can actually zoom in and see all the individual threads and get that appearance. So getting crazy detailed models that we're doing now. So Luxion, talk a little bit about that. So that was a lot of academic research. So how do you actually put that into a sort of industrial setting? And how did that even come about? So Luxion was founded in 2003. It actually, we have two offices today. We have the headquarters here in Aarhus. A mile away from here, or a kilometer, one and a half. And then we have an office in California. We have most of the development here in Denmark. And when people ask, why do you have development in Denmark instead of California? And I always say, it's because it's so the winters are hard in Denmark. The computer is a nice place to be. You get the heat from the fan. people in California have too much sun. So we like the development here. And we like working with Aarhus University as well. So, we actually have two products we work on. One of course sort of really the start of Luxion. We've been working with Velux on a daylighting simulation tool, and then we have the KeyShot, which is sort of our main business. So Velux daylight visualizer. What happened in 2003 was I gave a talk at a conference about lighting, and I talked about these lighting simulation techniques. And Velux then approached me and said, we would love to be able to simulate that with software. We don't know anything about software lighting simulation. We know about windows. You can put window in a room. When we go to a house today, our salespeople do that. They say, this window will look great. Just trust me. And of course, you put it in, and then if you regret it, it's just too bad. I mean, it's an expensive process. So they wanted something that was a non-technical software. They wanted something that would be very easy to use. No rendering parameters. They didn't really want lighting algorithm knowledge to be in it. They wanted to be able to do it on a laptop, be very accurate. It should only be daylight. And then they wanted to make this free tool. And they still have that free tool today, by the way. It's called the Velux Daylight Visualizer. And basically, you could simulate lighting in buildings to validate that the skylight would add quality to the interior lighting in buildings. And we said, sure, we can do that. And here, 16 years later, we're still working on it. But what we have today is a tool that actually is pretty powerful. We can import lots of geometries for buildings. And you can add windows in it. And you can get pictures out of what it could look like under sunny or sky or cloudy daylight conditions. You can get various lighting configurations out. And it's actually been validated to do a correct lighting setup, so you can actually use this to validate the lighting in the building before you build it. They've done a lot of testing of this. This is sort of an older example, but one of these images here is a rendering of a building before it was built under daylighting, and then the other one is the actual building photographed. So there are some differences. It wasn't done to model it super carefully, but it just shows you how you, with computer graphics and lighting simulation, can get a good idea of what kind of lighting you'd have in a building. Now, around 2006, we were playing around with this ray tracing technology that we had already been sort of using in a daylight visualizer, and we noticed we could make it faster because Velux kept saying, we don't want to wait that long for all this lighting. How hard can it be? So we kept working on making it faster and faster, and we could start doing sort of interactive things. In computer graphics, if you worked in that area, you know that we do a lot of teapots and bunnies for historical reasons. And we could do those pretty fast, sort of 20 frames a second at that time. And we used various technical algorithms for that. So what we started doing was we started putting it all together in a package where we just simulate the lighting on the fly, kind of like a camera. You could move the camera around, and we had the computer now work like a camera. And we started, and that's kind of why the name KeyShot came about. And that really to think you can just have sort of a camera, your computer be the camera instead, and really in many ways replace the idea of having to use a camera. At this time, I've been working a lot with different visual effects studios and in the movie business, and of course they're very technical. A movie like Avatar was 800 people working on it for 4 years, and very technical people, very delicate knowledge. I mean, they know every parameter in the software, they can tweak it. Most people don't work like that. They don't necessarily know all these technical algorithms. So we wanted to make something that could be easy and used for a wider audience. One of our first examples was working with Ford. So we worked with Ford, went to the Detroit Auto Show, and every year they make a car for that show, and they wanted to have some press photos of the car. And the one guy they worked with for a long time is called David Burgess. He's a car photographer. At the time, this was in late 2006, he had never used software. He'd always used, he used maybe Photoshop, but he had been going into the desert with 10 guys that hold up reflector screens, and they would illuminate the car that he had, and then he would photograph it, make beautiful images, because he could say, what should a quality photograph look like? But he always worked with the actual car. So Ford said, we need photographs of this interceptor car. And he said, sure. But he said, unfortunately, we don't have the car. So you have to work from a 3D model. And he's like, how am I going to do that? And we had done some talks with Ford at the time. And they said, you had to use this brand new software that is supposed to work like a camera. And you have to fly to California and do that. And he agreed to that. he came out, and in the first 2 days, he just, I miss my camera so much. I mean, what is this sitting in front of the computer? And this is sort of one of the early pictures he did. But then he went back to his hotel room and started playing with light, the way you can do it. He's been used to being a victim of sort of, if it's a cloudy day, he couldn't get the great picture of the car he wanted. He had to wait for the sunny day. He had to wait for the lighting conditions to be perfect. But he went back to his hotel room, made some complete custom lighting, and got these sort of nice stripes on the car, and he was all excited. And he started buying into this idea of using the computer to replace photographs. And he gave these to Ford. They said these are the photographs of the car, even though the car did not exist. And he was even put in on the cover of Auto Week as, here's a photograph of this car that actually didn't exist at the time. So we thought that was pretty cool validation. And this really was sort of the start of KeyShot. So KeyShot is more technical description, but the idea of this is really, it's a photograph for your product, but your product is now all digital. It lives in the computer. And really with KeyShot, what you can do, and what has started happening, is that when companies make products nowadays, they used to you'd have a digital description, a CAD model, a 3D model of the product. You'd have materials assigned to that. You send that description to China. You'd wait 3 months or 6 months. You get a container back. You send your photographer down to that harbor. You get the first box out of the container, run back to the studio, start photographing it, making sure there's no sticky fingers on the cell phone or dust or whatever it is. So it's a pretty costly process, expensive process. There aren't that many photographers, so it takes time to get those pictures. What we've done now is when you send the, and then you can start your marketing campaign. What we've done now is when you send your 3D data to China, you can also put it into the software and you can start making photographs. You can start your marketing campaign before you even have the actual product available. So KeyShot, the process is you import that 3D data from basically your CAD description. We can import lots of different models from lots of different softwares and mix and match and so on. And then you can paint it up. We have a very extensive material library, both a library that lives in the cloud and in the software. So we have quite a few companies that have their own proprietary material libraries where we work with them to really match exactly what they have so that designers can work with that in an easy way. So the reason why we set up materials, you can basically drag them in on a model, is that you don't necessarily have to understand if you're doing milk, what kind of molecules are inside that glass to do it very accurately. Then you can adjust the lighting, which again is a nice thing to do. You can have natural environments, or you can do just your own custom lighting environment. So that's one of the big advantages on a computer, because the lighting is so hard to do in the real world. And then you can set up the camera, and then you get sort of final picture. This is just an illustration of an image. Now, KeyShot, we've had lots of different releases. We've had, we're now on KeyShot 8. One of the things we've done since day one is, because of our sort of basis in academia, is we've always worked with these very physically accurate materials. So if you have a model that you worked on in KeyShot 1, that Ford model that David Burgess had, you could still load it in, it looks the same. Some of the other softwares in this industry tend to change out material models, so we and they say they're physically based, so we joke the physics changes from year to year with their software. So we try to keep that all the same. And then we really have a focus on this not being movie software. So this is not intended for making movies, it's intended on making it easy to use and attract people that come with more like a photography background, industrial design background, and so on. Here's some of the rendering technology, and I can add that Toshiya Hachisuka actually used to be a professor here at Aarhus University, and we worked closely with him at design. So I'm trying to see if I can convince him to maybe come back to Aarhus. He's a very smart guy. What you can do with this kind of algorithm that we use inside of KeyShot, you can actually do very complex lighting effects. Here's an example of, if you have a light shining on a prism, reflecting on the inside of a cylinder, you get some super complex lighting where the light will spread out into different wavelengths, reflect inside in a complex way. And sometimes we have customers that demand that. So an example is, here's just some example from KeyShot 8, actually our latest version of what we can do. Here we have a spotlight, the shining light through a fog onto a product about to be revealed. We can do light focusing through glass spheres. we can do creepy things, such as hope. Let me go back to that one. That's not what it's not, I guess. So if you have a hard time sleeping tonight, just think about this person here. Sometimes we have to do complex materials, such as a sponge. I mean, there are customers that make sponges. And what's interesting about this one is that it's all a material effect. It's actually a smooth CAD surface. So a lot of companies we work with work in CAD. CAD is intended to make smooth surfaces. So if they had to model something like this, they would just, I think they'd all quit before even starting it. So this is all a material effect, but we can do that. And of course, you can take it to the next level. We work with actually Espen Osholm, is a very talented Danish guy who's sometimes takes the software and does some things, but like, how did you do that? So here's an example of melted foam, where he put together some different materials, mixed it in a certain way to create sort of a very complex appearance that we had to ask him, how did you do that? So that's a really fun part of working with a lot of different industries when they come back to you, like, are you sure you did that in our software? And then here's another example of more recently, as you get more complicated, you have products that have embedded metallic flakes inside of them. So like a plastic, could be a toothbrush, we have little metal flakes inside of them. Again, no one wants to model that. You don't want to sit and put little flakes inside of it. So we've now made a material where you can just add flakes and you get automatically inside the material. And when you think about that, it sounds very, very specialized. When we did that, we had so many people come back to us and say, oh, you saved my life, this is a game changer. I can finally get flakes inside of my material. And then again, these complex materials. Here's this glass that's transmitting certain wavelengths of light, reflecting other wavelengths. You can do this advanced filtering effect. We work with a number of companies that where this is very important as well. We've also worked on doing layered or stacks of thin films on glass, or coated glass. And we work with some sunglass manufacturers, where if you buy these cool sunglasses that look blue and transmit red light, it all comes from stacks of little thin film on the glass surface. Now we can simulate that very accurately. And the companies we work with have said, again, this is really changing the way they work, because they used to do it all, they do prototypes for all of that. So they would make tons of glasses, look at them, see what it looks like, and if they didn't like them, throw them away. So by doing it all on a computer, you actually save a lot of resources, save a lot of physical prototypes you normally have to do. Now you can do an accurate evaluation and assessment on the computer. Here, just different steel with different coatings on it. Again, trying to get very accurate representations of how steel can look as you prepare it in different ways. We also have a technology we can actually measure materials. Here's from a conference we had last year. We made a KeyShot bag for that conference. So this is a photograph. So in the front of the photograph, there's the bag that we had for the conference. We took a sample of the bag. We put in a scanner that you can see in the upper left corner of the photograph. And we took a sample of this bag and we scanned it. And then we applied it inside the software. And then on the monitor on the right side is a rendering in KeyShot of that material applied to another surface. So if you have materials and you say, I just want to have this material, I don't want to know what it's really made of, I just want to measure it, we can do that as well and do some accurate measurement where you can capture the little threads that are inside of that bag material. And then we have, of course, in the software as well, once you have your picture out and you're happy with it, photographs have all these adjustments. You can adjust the color temperature, you can adjust the brightness, and so on. And we have that as well, you can do it all in real time. And then we work with the architects as well, where we have a setup that can simulate really complex interior lighting efficiently. That's a request, again, motivated a lot by VLUX, giving us some complex models that they wanted us to simulate. Here's an example. So VLUX has a product called sun tunnels, or solar pipes, or solar tube, where basically you have a receiver on your roof, and then you have a very reflective pipe that guides the light inside a building. And that's an innovative way to get light inside a building where you don't have room for a window. So like inside here, if you want a daylight to come in, you would have these pipes guide lighting. And they couldn't simulate that because it's so complicated. So we worked on some algorithms for quite a while to do that. And here's an example of a CAD model of a building where all these little holes on the top receivers of sunlight that then guide light inside the building through these discs that are inside the building. And here's what we added, which is in the VLOX daylight visualizer, where you can actually simulate light coming through from sunlight outside, and then you get a correct measurement of lighting inside the building. And now you can take that data, put it into KeyShot, and then you can then paint the model as well and simulate what this would look like, this bathroom, under various daylighting conditions. Here's just another example. I'm going to show some custom examples now. Here's a Chrysler with a headlamp simulation. You have the lighting pattern coming out from the headlamp. Of course, they use it more for like actual automotive renderings. Whenever you see a car ad where the car is parked on the top of the mountain and you wonder how they got it there, they didn't get it there. It's all computer graphics. So this is all, that's just the way it is now. So pretty much if you look at product catalogs nowadays, it's just all computer graphics. I mean, there's very few photographs out there because it just takes so much time and it's so much easier to do. Even something as mundane as the IKEA catalog, or mundane, that's a strong, but even like the IKEA catalog, it's like 95% of it is all computer graphics. That kitchen with the plates that are stacked in a skewed way, they have software that does that for them, so it looks like it's not computer graphics. And again, just some more examples. We always like cars. Cars are cool. So here's an Audi website. Again, you go configure a car now, buy a car. It's all computer graphics presented to you. So even the trees in the background are computer graphics. So one of the things we do like in KeyShot that makes it special is we work with customers that have large data. Not just physically large, like a Caterpillar truck, but also large in terms of the amount of polygons they put into it. So here's an example. It has a 500 million polygons. It's really heavy data sets that they load. And this is even from a couple of years ago. So today I wouldn't be surprised if it's twice that size. But what they like is just being able to load in that data and not worry about does it fit or anything like that. It just has to work. There's some aircraft here. And of course, if you buy a custom aircraft, you want to have the interior designed to the way you like it as well. And then here's bicycles. We like bikes as well. So I'm always happy with Specialized. They did the whole marketing campaign in KeyShot. And then another one is Peloton, if you like spin bikes. Sometimes they do mix in people or other real world things. So like this case, the treadmill is computer graphics, and then the lady there is an actual person. A few years back, we worked with Microsoft. They did the whole Surface marketing campaign in KeyShot. And if you buy any product from them, the keyboard, the picture on the box would be have been done in KeyShot. So pretty much if you buy a sort of electronics nowadays, there's a very good chance the picture on the box is made in KeyShot. Here's a Lenovo again. There's some, we've made sales for these. This is not an example. Let's see if, so you can see on this monitor here, one thing you may not think about is that if you look at a cell phone, or you look at a watch, or you look at a laptop, they always have this reflection line across the screen on the surface. So we made it in the software to actually click on a screen so we want that reflection line. That's something that's so important for designers or photographers that we made a feature just for them to place that reflection line accurately on the screen because they use that so much. And it can be hard to do if you have an outside lighting environment. They always stand and sort of wiggle it around. But in the software, we can say, okay, this is where you want it, that's where you'll get it. Sunglasses and jewelry as well. And then this one, Coca-Cola. We had Coca-Cola actually gave a talk at our conference, and even the Coca-Cola is tall computer graphics now. The bubbles, everything, they model that. One thing that's interesting about this picture is that you think they put a Coca-Cola bottle in with a lady in on a bench on it, and then she might be a photograph, but everything is 3D, even the lady. Because if they want to zoom in on the bottle or change the angle, it doesn't work to just embed this in a photograph. So now you can see how the out-of-focus region changes and how her appearance in the bottle changes and in the drops as well. So everything is just becoming 3D nowadays, even what used to be just background material. Sometimes we have to do illustrations, so we can do these cutaways, we can remove part of the model. We've made software to do that just automatically because it's very difficult to model. And then sometimes it has to look a little bit more stylistic, cartoonish. Yeah, there are lots of products out there. So sometimes they have to look a little different, more like a cartoon. Here's for the character design. We do actually work, you can say that we do mainly product design, but in, of course, the movie industry, they also have products. That's the characters they put in the movies. So I actually work with quite a few studios that use KeyShot to the product design or the character design inside of KeyShot. This is another example. I don't know if this ended up in a movie or not, but and then the watches. Here's an example from a fossil watch manufacturer in the US. They use KeyShot, and we work quite closely with them because what they do is when they make a watch, they have to make it in lots of different colors. So we've made technology to basically add configurations. When you have one product, you can have it in many different configurations, different colors, different faces inside of the software. And see if I can play this one here. It's just an example of, we also do animation in KeyShot, and here's a just a product from Fender, where you can notice the detail in some of the materials, and then also how they show all the different color variations and everything, and it makes it much easier to have that again in software, and you can easily animate it and have just a quick little animation. So where we are today with KeyShot, and what we're really doing is we're looking at making images and using it as a camera for your data. That works really well. But nowadays, there are just so many demands for getting your data out. You want it out as just pictures, like photographs. Where do they go? Do they go on the web? Do they go in a marketing campaign? Do they go on a poster? Do you want it inside some dynamic environment? Do you want it on Facebook as a VR experience? There's a new format for that called DLTF. And there are these new formats and experiences coming out all the time. Do you want a VR experience? We're working on that right now, quite actively, and about to release a product for doing it VR, so you can put on a headset, you can actually see your product and experience the scale of it. Or do you just want someone else to view it on their monitor and have a 3D model? So we're trying to support all of these things and bring the data into KeyShot, have that as sort of a source. We can send the data out to all these different channels. And the viewer as an example, it's used by a company called Under Armour. Here's just an example for them, where they have a shoe. And they used to make tons of shoe samples and send them around, the physical prototypes. Now they can just load it up inside of KeyShot. And then we have this viewer where they can share it. They can click around and see what are the different color types that they want to actually produce instead of having to make physical prototypes. And this, I think, is really changing again a lot of physical prototypes and reducing cost as a consequence. VR, we do have some newer things with this. Unfortunately, I cannot really show that. But VR, you put on a headset, you want to look at that car before you buy it. You want to see it in front of your house and see if it looks nice. And you want to maybe sit inside of it and feel see what it feels like. And what we've done is when you set it up in KeyShot, you can actually just press one button and then you can have it in VR. And what's different about VR and where we had to change the technology a little bit is that you actually need 90 frames a second to get a good, smooth experience. We can really move around in a very natural way. And we've developed all of that and about to launch a product for that. And if you want to see that, then Jesper Mosergaard is right here. He can show you all of that. I don't think he has anything here today, but if you're interested, definitely talk to him. Almost done. So I said we started working with the movie industry, but what happened is we actually don't really work with them actually, but they do use KeyShot for some of the character work that they do. And in Star Wars Rogue One, where they had Princess Leia and Tarkin, they actually used KeyShot to validate that they could do the characters accurately enough to do a digital actor in a movie. So we're pretty excited about that. And it was modeled by Marco Di Luca for that movie, I guess based on maybe this face that he did. I'm still not going to say which side is the photograph, which side is the rendering. But I'm just going to leave it with that, say thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. want to pull out two chairs and just sit for an hour with you and discuss all these things. Unfortunately, we don't have that time, but I am going to take the liberty to go a little bit into the break because there are some things that I would like to ask you. So I hope you'll bear with me and enjoy these questions also. Well, one thing was that I actually watched Avatar with my daughter the other day, a little preparation for this talk, and she asked me the question, what's more expensive and more complicated, making a movie with real people or making one with computer animated figures?
Well, computer animated is very expensive. If you look at Avatar, which was a breakthrough in many ways in 3D, having 800 people work on 4 years on just the effects, I mean, that's very costly. And you have, what, 20 people jumping around in a forest? You could probably do that on a much lower budget. So it is expensive, but obviously the technology is moving forward. As with all software, it just gets more and more efficient, and that's what they're looking at now. How can we do more and more with this? And for now they're making Avatar 2 and 3, so because they can now reuse a lot of the technology and so on. And of course, they can create experiences that you cannot make with real people. So they actually have some of the scenes in Avatar, they have the real people replaced by a computer graphics. So when they're jumping out of helicopters, it's all digital because the real actor.
So does that mean that there is no use for stuntmen in the future?
Probably not. I mean, a lot of it is starting to be replaced by computer graphics because you can imagine, I mean, stunt acting is dangerous. So again, do you want to jump out of that car, drive down the road at 100 kilometers an hour? Do you want to have a computer graphics person do that where they can sit in the basement and make it all happen? So I would agree with that.
You've shown us really convincing examples of something that looks so close to human beings that we can't even tell the difference. So this also raises some ethical questions because it creates the opportunity of making deep fakes of using, you know, of not even just using someone else's picture, but creating someone else's picture and using it in a sort of compromising situation. What thoughts are you having around these sort of ethical questions with the work that you're doing?
I mean, it's always complicated, and I think you can do that with anything. I mean, you could also make a picture of a product and sell it, and it doesn't even exist. So you can exploit all this technology in so many ways, and it's really difficult to sort of control that when you create it. You just want to achieve a goal, and making sure that bad actors don't abuse it is just very difficult, and it's hard to say. I mean, but you can do the deep fakes. You can do it in so many different ways. You can do them not only creating them from scratch, but then all the deep learning technology coming out now, we can actually just manipulate videos and put in other people's faces and so on. So it's difficult. And I think that as the technology gets better and better, it gets harder and harder to deal with that.
This is why I usually tell people that are very, shocked of the teenagers sharing naked pictures of each other that they can't tell their teenagers not to share pictures because you can do it anyway, so they should talk to their teenagers about like why they should respect privacy, and this is the conversation we need to be having. So one final question. It's pretty obvious that we could create digital twins or avatars of ourselves in a virtual reality space. Is that, are we seeing this happening? Will we be able to, like, we know that Facebook owns Oculus Rift, and will we be wandering around in a VR Facebook looking exactly like ourselves in the future, and how soon?
With a lot of smart people working on that. Right now the technology is not quite there, and it's still a little bit of ways, but I'd say there's so much happening in this space that it is going to happen at some point, but it's still a very, very complicated thing to do because making it all feel very natural is just difficult, and I'd say that's why it's an exciting problem.
And that's where we land in the uncanny valley. You have to be careful not to do that.
And if you look at the experiences they have now, it's all these sort of stick figures they have in VR, because even just getting the surrounding scene to work is difficult enough. And actually seeing someone else in that space is really difficult, but it's certainly some of the things that we're looking at, if we could do that, because it has huge applications. I mean, right now, I'm a bit jet-lagged and hazy because I arrived late last night and have so if I could just have a digital version of me here, I could sit at home, just have some coffee. Maybe I'm standing in my robe, I just got out of bed, but you see me all, that could be quite nice to have a future.
So the problem here is that that is a service that goes on in real time. So you have to render
it
in real
really,
time.
Really difficult. I mean, you can do it today with kind of stick figure avatars, but make it look really realistic at that speed is difficult. And then having the rest of the environment seem natural, it's difficult. But there are a lot of people working on it and say, computer games is kind of like they're pushing the envelope there by really trying to make it an engaging experience. And I think we're seeing a lot of exciting technology come out from that area. And what we're looking at is sort of just the idea of experiencing your product. So you can say the barrier there is a little bit lower, where you can have that static car model, maybe you can walk around that.
But we feel starting there and then taking that to the next level where you now have, we're talking to companies, and actually I went to Oculus and talked to them. What they like, since it's Facebook, is they like it's a social company. So they want multiple people interacting with the product at the same time. And we now work on that as the next level. How can we have multiple people looking at, let's say it's car designers. How can they socialize around this idea of designing a car so they don't always have to fly to the same location again and again to discuss design details? So that's why I see a lot of the innovation coming in the next just couple of years.
I guess it's also an ecosystem where it's not just the software, but it's also what the hardware can manage and also what the network sort of supports.
Yeah, that's okay. Exactly right.
Thank you very much, Henrik. Give him a big hand.